Okay, thank you very much, Raja. I'll stand there. Is it all right?
Yeah, just be careful that you know one step you are.
Okay, I might fall down. So very good afternoon to everyone. First of all, I'd like to thank this site for inviting me to present something from Sabah. Yeah? I was told that most of these talks are dealing with fauna and flora. But I thought that geology is also heritage. Yeah? So today, I try to explain and share with you some of the wonderful geological heritage that you can actually find in Sabah. But before that, some of you might be questioning what is this geological heritage thing. Yeah? So basically, it's actually related to the geological resources, not the conventional geological resources, but more for the intrinsic intrinsic knowledge that we have at a particular site. I just give you a very simple example. You know limestone, you know? Limestone, we use them, we quarry them to make cement, or we make them into like tiles and block stones and all those kind of things. Or we make them for road, aggregates for road. Yeah? So we used to look at limestone as such. But now we should look at limestone more than that. So what is more than what I've already said just now? Actually, the knowledge behind that limestone. Specifically, the historical knowledge related to that particular limestone. So if we know the historical, basically we're not talking about not the normal history, but the geological history behind that limestone, then you put value to that limestone. And for example, if that particular limestone was one of the oldest in Malaysia, for example, and it's located in Perak, this is an example. And in that particular limestone, you have beautiful fossils there, and you can't find anywhere else in Malaysia, or for that matter, around the world. So you have two choices. Do you want to protect that limestone, or you want to mine that limestone for your use, for your conventional use, for you know, construction use? Or use to choose the latter, because we think that we can generate money directly, and we use it for construction anyway. And we don't see the need for it to be conserved. But nowadays, we are looking at it in terms of our heritage value. Because if we protect that particular limestone, it will generate much more income for us in the long run compared to actually just taking it, extracting it, using it, that's gone. And the future generations will enjoy it for as long as we want it to be. This is what I'm talking about. This is the geological heritage. So we're actually looking at more than what we see from the outside, but more the inside. Okay? I think that's... Okay. So I'll start by showing you a geological, just elevation model of Sabah. For those who are not familiar, this is where the Taknabalo is. And this wide area here are high mountains. This is Mount Kinabalu around here. Those lowlands are green stuff around here. And you were hearing about Sandakan just now, where the Sunbay are being, you know, looked after. And of course, you have this famous Malayo basin around here, that rounded basin down there. You have Danon Valley here, one of the oldest rainforest around here, and you have several areas. Down here you have Pulau Padan, one of those famous, you know, places that you want to go and do your diving area here. So basically this is how it looks like. So today I'll be sharing some of these sites around here. If you look at this in terms of putting the geological map, so we just overlay the map on top. And you can see some yellow color here, some green and all those kind of things. You don't have to worry about that at the moment. What I'd like to show you is that basically we have three types of rocks in Sabah. This yellow color here are basically sedimentary rocks. Yeah? I'll show you a metatandaan, get rid of that. So this yellow here are basically sedimentary rocks. Sedimentary rocks are, you know, sandstones and mudstones, layers. Whereby you also have all these igneous rocks here. Mount Kinabalu, for example, is red. These are igneous rocks. You also have igneous rocks in Tawau around here. And of course, you have all these ultra basic rocks, very interesting rocks that you have in Sabah. Ultra basic rocks, you can't actually find that many in the peninsula. Just a little bit of outcrop here and there. But in Sabah, you have lots of these ultra basic rocks, and they, you know, have they have their own ecosystem, in a sense, if you look at it later. So, what I'll do is I'll just give you a brief background of our geological setting. So, Sabah is around here. So, what happened at this time is that Sabah actually is located near three major plate movements. So, we have this Aleutian plate down here, which actually moving towards the southeast at about 5 centimeters per year, it's moving that way. And to the south, we have this Indian and Australian plate here moving northward about 70 centimeters per year. And of course, we have this Philippine and at the back, it's the Pacific plate pushing towards the west about 10 cm. And all these are actually compressing and actually allocated right at this place here. And that's why I'm actually experiencing some earthquakes around here. Yeah? I'll just show you plate, it's another time, how this plate goes is something like that. So all this plate comes down, it gets stuck somewhere there, and then it generates earthquake. Why this plate are moving is basically how earth looks something like that. It's like an egg, and this is shell, eggshell there, and actually this is the one that moves around, whereas the center is more or less there. Now, if you look at Sabah, it used to be that, you know, Sabah, you look at that, was not like that before. Now you can see all this plate coming in, and this Pacific, this is the Australian coming colliding. And so we have a lot of compression going on here. And that's why it is called the Ring of Fire, all the way from Japan, Philippines, and going down. Of course, we are located inside, so we are always like slightly safe in that sense. We are still getting a little bit of crevice because we are quite near to the Philippines around here. Yep. So that's a very short overview. Now, I'd like to explain this geological heritage in terms of history. In terms of history. Because to be able to appreciate geological heritage, you must at least know the geological evolution of an area. Because if I just tell you that this outcrop is so and so, and this is very important, you will not be able to appreciate it unless you understand a little bit of how they came about. And this is what I'm trying to tell you. Not until about 20 million years ago, Sabah, as we know today, because most of it is actually under the sea. Under the sea. That's very young, it's a very young country in terms of geology. And actually, what actually happened is that we have an oceanic crust about 200 million years old, becoming the basement of Sabah as we see it now. Where Sabah is actually now standing on top of this basement rock. And they are basically oceanic crust, and this oceanic crust was formed as part of the Tethys Sea. You know, Tethys Sea actually is a huge sea that separates this huge continent, Laurentia and Gondwana land to the south. You have this Tethys Sea from Europe, and it goes all the way to area around Sabah. Sabah would be around here. So you can see here how it separates, and then I'll show you. The Tethys Sea is going that way. So what we have in Sabah is that we have this remnant of this sea. So if you want to see an old, you know, leftover of a sea called Tethys, then you have to go to Sabah. Then you'll be able to appreciate what I'm saying. So again, where are these Tethys remnants? Here, we have this in Pulau Bangi, in Ranau, all these weird colors here in purple. These are ultra basic rocks, and also we have it in huge Ladatu area around here. Now, as I said earlier, look at this. This is a cross section of how Sabah developed. Imagine this was a sea before, and now now we started with a small island here. So about 70, 90 million years ago, there was a lot of, you know, compression. Because this plate was moving this way, this plate was moving that way, and so it created this uplift around here. So about, you know, 70 or 90 million years ago, a lot of this was accreting and then forming little islands. And one of the earliest islands where some of these limestones was actually developed on top is the Madai limestone. This is the oldest limestone in Sabah. It's not as old as limestone in the peninsula, of course. But still, it's very significant because it's one of the oldest that actually was developed as the land, as land was being formed. It's isolated. This sea used to be the proto South China Sea, which now, of course, has closed, as you see later, this moved on, and all these sediments on top here were then added here, and that's how Sabah became that size now. So, if you go to the next slide, you see it moves about 40, 50 million. Now, more stuff are being created. Now, you have the East Sabah landmass forming. So, you're asking about where is the first landmass of Sabah? So it is the eastern part of Sabah. Because at that time, western part of Sabah was not existed yet, about 40, 50 million years ago. I would say that at this time, 40, 50 million years ago, then probably you're already developing a good forest around here. Before that, if you look at that, it will be like limited to small little patches of islands, about 70, 90 million years old. So if you're looking for early forest in Sabah, still you have to go to the east, eastern part, and then probably hidden somewhere down there. Now, as we go along, during the Oligocene Miocene, which is about 20, 25 million years ago, you have this compression ongoing. So now you have eastern Sabah and now adding west Sabah down here. Now it's getting uplifted, more land mass now being formed. Yeah? Sabah is being enlarged about that time. You also have volcanic activity in the eastern part of Sabah. So you have volcanic activities, like very violent activity. Then, about 18 to 20 million years ago, Sabah was split into two. Very, very, very strange. Remember, it was like this before, and there was some split in the middle, around here. Something like that. And that created an elongated basin. You know, all this blue stuff are still under the sea, which is some land. So we have West Sabah, East Sabah here, and in between, you have this central elongated basin with a lot of sediments. Once this is uplifted, eroded, all this will be filling around this basin around here. Yeah? So it's filling all this kind of thing. So we have a lot of stuff there. And later, these sediments was being filled, and you create this circular basin. One of these circular basins that I will explain later is Malaya Basin. Now you know how Malaya Basin actually came about. It came about later, and because of that elongated basin in between, we find them in the central part of Sabah. Quickly. And then of course, finally, about 2 to 7 million years ago, Sabah was more or less what you see today, was more or less established. What you see as the landmass of Sabah was more or less established by 2 million years ago. And so we have intrusion rocks, this is Mount Kinabalu coming out. And of course we have volcanoes, active volcanoes in Tawau and Sampurna, which I will show you later very quickly. Yeah? And so the first geological heritage that I think we'd like to discuss here is this oceanic crust. As I said, this represents the remnants of the Tethys Sea ocean floor. And now you can find it in Sabah. You can't find it in Peninsula. You only find it in Sabah because there was a lot. And this is how an oceanic crust looks like. Oceanic crust actually forms like this. You have magma coming in, and every time the magma comes in, it will add to the side, and then this huge oceanic crust will enlarge. Yeah? Starting from a small oceanic crust, it enlarges every time the red stuff adds here. And you have interesting structure. At the bottom, we have Cape Road. This is some very nice rock here. Then you have this sheeted dike, you have basalt, below basalt, and then you have chert and mudstone on top here. What I'd like to show you is that all this we have in Sabah. You know, you can find them many places. But if you don't understand this, you won't appreciate them. Now that I've shown you that you are looking at an ancient Tethys oceanic floor, then probably you'll want to touch that now. So, the oldest rocks can be found in Lahadatu. This is the Lahadatu town. And then all these things. So you can actually see, these are these rocks here that have drawn lines. They have sheets. They have sheets like this. Yeah, sheets. This is actually magma coming out and intruding out. So you can actually see. And underneath, you have this gabbro. Gabbro. Gabbro is actually a very, you know, old part of the oceanic crust down here. You can see it here. And there are veins foliated around here. This actually is in Denham. So if you want to see this kind of rock, you have to go to Denham Valley. Denham Valley is actually the place for looking at the oceanic crust. At the same time, you also find, because it's distributed all over the place, in Kota Marudu, around here, you find this pillow basalt. Those pillow basalt. Why is it called pillow basalt? Because when they form, when they come out from the sea, this magma, as they come out to the sea, they cool down. Once they cool down, they become like pillows. They just make pillows structure. And this is how it looks like. Look at this guy, he's holding all these pillows. And you know, but they are huge pillows, of course. Some of my students, all these are pillow lava, but of course, you can't see them. And if you look at closer, you can see it. Very nice. This is a combustible scale. And in fact, this area was mined for manganese long time ago in 1912. By the British, when they were here, they did some mining activity, looking for manganese. But of course, they didn't find much, so it was closed down. Actually, this manganese are derived from oceanic floor, oceanic crust. Now, another outcrop is in Pulau Bangi here. I just want to show you. Here you can actually see all these pillows. This is hammer for scale. And in fact, all these are this stuff here. And we were doing field work here. We had a nice stream also, with a lot of water. This is the guy sitting there. So very nice features. Also, we have sedimentary rocks on top. As I said, these basalts are kept by sedimentary rocks. These sediments are deep water sediments, probably 3-4 kilometers deep, right there in the center of the ocean. And actually, we have this in Sabah. And you know, you can only find this kind of stuff in Sabah. A little bit in Sarawak, and a little bit in Peninsula also. We find one or two along the round, you know, area. But most of it you can find in Sabah, and if you dig inside, you'll find a lot of these radiolarian fossils. Very, very minute. You can't actually see them. You have to look at them in a microscope. And you use this to date, to determine the age of the oceanic crust. Because you can date them. And as I said, most of these radiolarians are between 80 to 130 million years old. Meaning that the oceanic crust, the proper basalt, must be older, lying below here. This is the youngest part of the oceanic crust. Now, during the early uplift of Sabah, you have these small little islands, as I said. Then you have this Madai limestone. So this is the Madai limestone. Here you can see it, and actually it's a very interesting cave because it has an underground waterway also. It has not been fully explored. People have not actually gone inside and really do a lot of mapping inside. And apart from that, you have these caves, wide network, and underground stream. This is one of the most important archaeological sites also, because in here, most of the archaeological sites suggest the earliest people staying in Sabah was staying around here, because you have cave stay for people to actually live. Yeah? And that's where the archaeological work is being carried out. And yeah, also, it's a very important area for all these birds' nests, swiftlets, for example. You can see swiftlets here, and of course, a lot of. So, another interesting thing is this Madai cave is so popular at that time that this one, Annie Bracey, she's a baroness from UK, visited this. You see her sitting there, being carried, and going to this cave. Even the drawing actually mimics the entrance of the cave. So, What I'm saying is, apart from the rock itself, it's interesting. You have caves there, which is all add to the interest. You have birds there. You have cultural heritage there. You have history there of famous people going there. Put that together, we have a total geological heritage in that area. That's what I'm saying. And then, of course, another limestone. This is the younger limestone. As more areas of Sabah was uplifted, you have this limestone coming up. And this is a Komanto limestone here. Very nice. It's not a big cave, but you know, very nice cave down here. And if you look closely, you can actually see that these limestones are made up of corals. Corals. You can see the spots there, spores. It's actually a coral. As you see, like modern corals, but these of course are 20, 25 million years old. Okay. And of course, this one is also a very important site for bird's nest, cultural site also. Near Kinabatangan, around here, same, we have this Batu Tulung limestone. Very strange, one block of huge limestone, which you have to see black around here. Actually, those are holes like this inside, very high. This is for scale. And you can actually find lots of coffin. There are found 41 coffin inside. Old ancient coffin, and they dated this coffin to be about 500 to 900 years old inside. And so actually was, I mean, you can see the head of a buffalo here, sculptured nicely inside. And the rest is actually just put outside there. So there was people living here about 900 years ago. They were already, you know, staying here, but they're using this as a burial ground. How they carried that coffin all the way up here is still a mystery. This is a suggestion that it used to be the sea level at that time was higher. So it was not difficult for them to carry it up there. Now the sea level has gone down and probably that's why you left it up there. Otherwise they would just probably use ropes to carry it up. Yeah, to add to the mystery of the whole thing. Also in the Palambangan Island here, we have huge caves inside there. We did some work there. But I would like to point out also that this limestone are home to very unique snails. You know, in Peninsula also, this limestone, apart from looking at the rocks, actually, you know, snails survive on good soil. Basically, they survive on very high calcium and soil. And so in areas that is soil are from the limestone, you find, according to some studies done, more than 10 times snails in a particular area. Because you know, snails use calcium carbonate as their shield, and so naturally they have this. And unfortunately, if you know about a situation here in Peninsula, we have a lot of limestone impact. Most of this limestone now are being quarried, and some, in fact, according to some study, year 2000, something like that, they did some study, and they even found out that some of this limestone have their own endemic species of snails. And it was there, like maybe 20 years ago, now it's gone. Once the limestone is gone, this poor snail species also goes with them. And the reason for that is we don't really see them because they are very small snails. And we don't see the value as limestone as apart from using it as for our building materials. But the heritage value, this is more like a biological heritage value that we're losing. But remember, geological heritage is happening. And then as we go further, I'm going to do it very fast. The other interesting feature is the Malaya Basin. Malaya Basin is this round basin here. You can see it, the rim is down here. This is called the Lost World of Borneo. You might wonder, why do you call it Lost World? Because to go up here, one would know, but here, it's difficult because it's very steep. You need the whole day to just climb up. So you can't actually log it because, you know, tractors cannot go up. So it's hidden. It's a hidden garden inside. And of course, you have beautiful waterfalls down there. Most beautiful waterfalls. And occasionally, we find this subway inside that forest there. I did some work there in year 2000. What I did was to map the whole area. I spent 2 years in Malaya Basin, mapping the basin, learning about the geology of the area. I don't have time to tell that. But I will just let you know that we did mapping of the waterfalls, and I identified 28 waterfalls. more than 5 meters tall. These numbers are written here. These are waterfalls inside. So this is the most densely populated waterfall area in Malaysia. You cannot find anywhere else, even in the world, who can actually build this area here. Because we have waterfalls everywhere. Huge. Yeah. And of course, Mount Kinabalu. Who didn't know Mount Kinabalu? This is a geological map of Mount Kinabalu. Now here, Mount Kinabalu was formed like this. You have this thickest oceanic crust around here. You have sedimentary rocks. What happened was about 40, 50 million years ago, it was folded and uplifted, and Mount Kinabalu came around 7 to 8 million years ago. Now it's eroded, now you have Mount Kinabalu down here. And if you look at the cross section, it looks something like that. That red blob there actually is this one. Okay? For your information, quickly. So on top, what's special about Mount Kinabalu? On top of Mount Kinabalu, we have remnants of glacial scouring. The only place in Malaysia we have remnants of ice. Glacier. And you can actually see all this based on our mapping, that you can actually see all these glaciers coming out from this area around here. This is the area here. This is the Kinabalu West, Kinabalu East around here. And this is actually, why is it a plateau? Because it has been eroded by glacial process. And this is a picture of it on top. You can actually see weird U-shaped valleys. And they are very smooth. So only glaciers can actually make surface smooth. So when you go up to the Mount Kinabalu, you can actually see that here. And you can even see grooves. These grooves are left over when the ice slided down, and you have pebbles below, you know, created all these grooves. Yeah, these grooves here. And at the same time, you have this glacial deposit right here below. So one of the glacial deposits is just below in the in Panalaban. This way, Panalaban is the place where during the earthquake some of this rock fell down and then killed about 18 people down there. Yeah? But in fact, there's already a lot of rocks down there. And then another interesting thing in Sabah is you have this glacial deposit at the foot of Mount Kinabalu. This is Kundasang. You have this huge area here made up of Pinoso travel, because this place is called Kampung Pinoso. And these are basically glacial deposits. A lot of you might not know, but if you want to touch glacial deposit, you go to this place and you can actually feel the glacial deposit there. Most of these occurred about 10 to 20,000 years ago. Okay? Now, if you go up, there are different diverse rock types. For us, if you go up the mountain, you started seeing sandstone, ultra-basic, granodiorite, and towards the top here, you have different kinds of granite or granodiorite, which is actually, for geologists, they really, really enjoy looking at the area. But for most people, the only goal is to go to the top and run back. And that is, they miss the geological heritage. But if you understand geological heritage, you'll spend more time on the mountain and enjoy the mountain more. That is the message. And then, of course, it's also home for unique array of lots of habitats, plants and species and all this kind of thing. You must have heard before that Mount Kinabalu, because of the geology, because of its height, its unique height, you have changes in altitude. And of course the rock types also are quite diverse. So it creates all sorts of plants, and it's one of the richest spot diversity spots in the world as of now. But of course, during the earthquake, most of it, you know, has been destroyed. You have seen this picture, but it's quite sad. It's huge, expensive landslide, Sasakai, and destroyed a lot of this ecosystem. Now, I will quickly talk about volcanoes. Somebody asked, oh, do you have volcanoes in Sabah? Yes, we have volcanoes in Sabah. We have volcanoes in Tawau. Look at that, we have cones, these Gunung Maria cones around here. And of course, I'll just add the geology on top. This is the cones around here, and I just get rid of that. And you can actually see a lot of volcanic cones. The big one is Gunung Maria. You have Bukit Tiger, Table, Bombalai, Andrasi, all this. Along the stretch, even this pulau, Gaya, is a volcanic caldera. It's actually a volcanic island here. So what can we do? Here, we have one site here, Bukit Tiger. This is Bukit Tiger, surrounded by all land now. But actually, they started quarrying one side of the hill. Now you can actually see an exposure of all this volcanic ash that when it erupts and falls, and then you have all these layers around here. Amazing that you can actually touch volcanic. You can't get it here, it's a legend. Then of course, just here, all this lava cooling down creates all these column basalts. You think that you only get this in Europe, you also have this in Sabah. You have a lot of this column basalt. Okay? Finishing, nearly finishing. Sorry. So, actually, volcanic activity also in Tawau creates this Badan Island, the most small Badan Island. See, Badan Island is actually, if you look at this, it's a volcanic island where corals actually grow around here. And it's actually isolated. The water is so deep, around it is about 1,000 meters. And actually, it's just surface. That's why it's so unique and so rich in diversity. You look at this picture here, this Padan, you can see that actually so much one of the richest marine diversity in the world is located here. Why? Because of the geology. It's not anything else, it's just because of the right geology. And then of course you have hot spring like this in Andrasi here. And now this area is now, not this particular area, but somewhere around here, is being developed as the first geothermal plant in Malaysia. Of that. Where else can you find? In Tawau, geology. And of course, interesting thing, mud volcanoes. Mud volcanoes are not hot, they are cold. Yeah? What happens is that they are compressed muds that comes out to the surface, like this one here. They don't have time. But I will just share with you three quickly ones. We have mud volcanoes in Pulau Tiga, mud volcanoes in Binuang, this is Miao Puna. And another one is Mintami, Ipan mud volcano here. Very quickly. Because, this is an interesting feature. It's called Pulau Tiga because it's made of one, two, three, one volcano. Stick together and it's called Pulau Tiga. Yeah, it's called Pulau Tiga. If you look at that, that's one volcano coming in. And actually, it's so popular, people go there and take the bath. You know? But a lot of wildlife also. And this used to be this survival island program that was very famous. They were put in this island and asked to, you know, survive there. The other one is in Ladang Binuang in Kuna. Two mud volcanoes here within this old palm. You can still see huge one. And you can still see it bubbling around. Quickly. Then of course you have this Lipan, huge one. This is for scale. And then about Itabin. And you can see that it's providing the natural salt for animals. And you can see all these elephants frolicking there. Oops. Time's up. What happened to them? What are two more slides? You just finish it. Alang alang. Hey, what happened? Okay, time's up. Oh, the computer on the battery. Anyway, yeah, I think I'm here. Nice place for them to go about. So this areas, see, so this is the value of this point volcano. As if you look at it, doesn't look very much like very interesting at all. But if you understand the value of it, not only for, you know, taking human bath, animals also get a lot of salt from this area. Now, just one more slide for Tanjung Mayau. This is actually one of the famous Tanjung Mayau. Tip of Borneo, they say. Why is it called tip of Borneo? Basically, because Borneo is like that, it's right at the edge here, South Korea. And this is, of course, very nice beach, white beach, and of course, a lot of geological features there, which I don't have time to explain. But I'd just like to point out that the Jesselton, a lot of the orchestra usually comes there, here, and play the orchestra there. And all because of this geological heritage kind of thing. And finally, this is in KK, just near Atakabalu. This is a beautiful Karampunai beach. And also we have this Karampunai estuary around here. You know what is interesting here is that you have fresh water here, and you have sea water here, just meeting in between. And actually, you can actually swim. It's very clean and, you know, clear, as you can see from the picture itself. And so, it's generated by this estuary, yeah? And that's why it's a very high, you know, hotels. Rasaria Hotel is here, and you have this Karampunai Resort located here. So they got the nice spot, and they choose that because of the geology that's provided by the area. Yeah? So I think basically that's what I wanted to share with you, because I don't have time. I could